Clearly, witches, Sabrina is just getting started. Yes, while I kind of felt that season one crossed a line towards the end there, and I'll explain why I felt that way, don't worry. But they got me at the end with that amazing tease, you know what I'm talking about, of Sabrina back with the weird sisters at the academy, right? Her hair gone from innocent golden blonde to angry bleached white. It was so good and so relatable because, ladies, when we get upset or frustrated, one of the first things we do is change our hair. So I thought that was just so good. And you know we're getting a hot love triangle in season two as well. I loved it when Nicholas Scratch and Harvey Kinkle finally met, right? That was great. It was a great moment. And we might even get a square if Harvey finds someone new, although I don't know if this show can handle any more characters. Anyway, overall, I'm very excited for season two, which is definitely coming. I think it's actually even been shot already because Netflix greenlit two seasons out of the gate. Oh boy, they're all in, and thank goodness, because the Satan stuff here, you know, is really, really, really on the line, right? I mean, I don't know if you saw that headline or that Twitter moment, that Church of Satan is suing, because although I have to say I think they might have a case because the show seems to have genuinely ripped off their statue, and they're like, that makes our statue and our church look evil, and it's like, you're the Church of Satan, right? I don't know. Anyway, I haven't seen too much of a backlash, though, but maybe not enough, you know, the audience hasn't gotten wide enough yet. But you know what? You would think maybe this would be like a problem because people would be like, oh, things are changing. This is something that, you know, this just shows how society is not going right. But you know what? I recently saw Hocus Pocus for Halloween this week. I rewatched it. I didn't remember it. I mean, I've seen it before, but I didn't remember the movie at all. And I was shocked at how edgy that movie was and how it crossed quite a few lines. And it was a Disney movie, no less. And that was back in 1993. So, and it did very well, by the way, on iTunes for Halloween. So maybe everybody is okay with this. And again, I don't want to be a wet blanket, but I have a really good point to make, but I don't want to get ahead of myself. But anyway, it was number three on iTunes, Hocus Pocus, over the on a Halloween. It did very well for the whole past couple of days for the holiday. And I have to say, I think the Chilling Adventures of Sabrina is probably the best Halloween entertainment since Hocus Pocus, which is very high praise. I would say they're not only similar, but of similar quality. I don't know. I think because of the budget and, you know, how much more sophisticated a 13-hour story can be, and because Hocus Pocus was trying to be a family movie, even though it kind of wasn't, but Sabrina very much is relishing in the line that it can cross on streaming, I would say this Sabrina show is like the next evolution of Hocus Pocus, which is even higher praise. I'm very, very happy with it. Overall, I love the rich atmosphere, but I also love the commentary from the gender politics, which never got grading, by the way, as they usually do, to rallying against the status quo, not only highlighting why sometimes it needs to be done, but also, and this is just as important, the cost that can come along with going against the group. Now, again, I feel the show did kind of cross a line, which I guess makes sense because towards the end of the show, we learned that this has all been about, at least from Mrs. Wardwell's perspective, of making Sabrina cross a line, to truly go to the dark side, right? I can't believe she signed that book. That's crazy. But anyway, and cross a line she does, not only signing that book to get true power, and she had an impressive display of power at the end there. I was all like, you know, and that's the problem with this show a little bit, because you're like, maybe it was worth signing away your soul in the book. And you're like, no, don't think like that. You're like, but did you see her cool blue fire powers? And you're like, no, it's never worth it. But anyway, she did slit Agatha's throat to bring her boyfriend's brother back from the dead, right? And I think, of course, Sabrina felt she could cheat death when she killed Agatha, and obviously she learned she couldn't. But to have the hero of the story, because Sabrina truly is, you know, portrayed as a very honorable or at least aspirational character, right, to the audience, that she would kill someone. And Agatha's okay, by the way. Agatha ended up being okay. I mean, she had a really rough stomach ache, basically, right? And Tommy didn't make it out okay. But overall, I think it sends the wrong message. I think they have to really be, you know, it's such a fine line. And I think for the most part, the show successfully walks it. But they have to really be careful. You know, I'm like, you're making a Satan worshiping show. It, you know, it's worth taking the extra time to make sure that you get it right. Because did you see, speaking of news stories, there was another one recently about two young girls who planned to stab much younger students at their school, like seemed like really little kids, and drag their bodies back to the bathroom where they would eat their flesh and drink their blood so that they could praise Satan. I think they wanted to go to hell and they felt this would be a great entrance, right? And they got like really far along. Like they had the knives and the goblet. I think they might have even caught them in the bathroom getting ready to plan this out. They'd drawn a map. And it's really, really disturbing. So I would hate to think that shows like this would encourage more of that. Like you saw the whole Slender Man thing, which apparently inspired a lot of girls, and they had some actual near murders because of that, right? So I don't want a show like this to create real world problems. And I'm sure the producers of the show don't want that either, nor does Netflix. I mean, they had cannibalism in episode 7, which I thought was really in bad taste. Couldn't help myself. But then also, when Miss Wardwell killed that poor virgin, that high school guy in the woods, I think they were kind of trying to show that he was going to pressure his girlfriend into sex. And I was like, I don't know, it seemed like he was pretty clear what was going to happen when he invited her to the woods. And that was definitely how Miss Wardwell got him out there in disguise. So that's like a really complicated situation. So I was like, yeah, he might be a jerk, but I don't think he deserves to die and to be sacrificed like that. I think that the cheapness of mortal life or the lives of those who you don't like or who you view as beneath you became so prevalent towards the end of the show that I would hate for anyone to feel that was therefore justified actions for them to take. As you can see, I'm sure, I know it's no fun to bring that element in, but you gotta do it. All right, now let's go character by character in order of my favorites. All right, so first off is Sabrina. Duh, right? This is the role that Kiernan Shipka was born to play. We've been talking a lot lately about the importance of good casting, and this is amazing casting. No one else can ever be Sabrina ever again. I mean, they could, but it won't be as good. And I think that she did a wonderful job as the golden child this season, and I have every confidence she will rock going full goth next season. And it's a credit to this show that I'm not quite sure if she'll go back to the way she was ever. I mean a lot more traditional shows perhaps would do that, but I would like to see be a bit of a mix, because just like mortals, I'm sure witches evolve through experience as well. Then my second favorite was Miss Wardwell. To me, Michelle Gomez here played the ideal witch, right? As lovely as Sarah Jessica Parker in Hocus Pocus, but competent and a genuine threat. Her bringing back the Greendale 13, itself very cool, by the way, and the Red Angel of Death, I loved all that, right, was a rare moment when a villain actually delivers. And I thought that was fabulous. I'm very curious to see where her character will go from here as well, especially with that reveal at the end as to her true face. I was like, oh, that's expensive. You're not going to be able to do that very often. Okay. Then I can't believe my third spot goes to Roz Walker, who at first I thought was a boring, thankless character, right? For Jazz Sinclair, I was like, this sucks for you, but at least you're working. But it became really cool. I thought the introduction of the Cunning was not only strong narratively, because it evens the odds for the mortals to have Roz on their side, right, against the witches, but played into the history of African-American storytelling with that kind of, supernatural element. I really liked it. I thought it was so super strong. I loved her grandmother as well. Great character. I'm hoping Sabrina can save her sight, but that Roz still gets to keep her new gift. I think that would be a wonderful arc for the character in the next season. And then I guess I have to go with Susie Putnam next. It was really a toss-up between Susie and Harvey for who would be next, but I think if you do Roz, then you got to do Susie. I think things got interesting with her, obviously, with the ghost of her relative showing up, Dorthea Putnam, who clearly was a lesbian back during the Salem witch trials, right, during that period, and who helped witches not only escape Europe, but helped them in the New World as well. I'm not quite sure, and I'd be interested for those of you who are from the LGBT community, how you feel about the show really strongly implying that being a member of the LGBT community is hereditary, because of course there was not only Dorthea, but also Susie's uncle. And so I've seen a couple of people criticize how this show handles LGBT matters and characters. And so I'd be very curious to hear your thoughts down below. I thought that Susie's story started out a bit cliche at the beginning of the season, but I felt that it was very fresh and also very realistic to add this new kind of angle to old witch stories, right? To have what would a lesbian at that time be doing? I thought it was really interesting and made the whole thing seem fresh, because we've had these kind of stories so often before. So I thought it was great. Now, of course, we're all wondering if that's really Susie's great relative Dorthea, or Miss Wardwell messing with her. I don't know. She seemed to help out a lot. So I'm thinking it might be maybe Dorthea. I liked when she stood up to the Red Angel of Death and, you know, or to that witch, and she said, "I'm the descendant of Dorthea Putnam who helped you guys out. So don't be a jerk. You owe me." And I thought that, although actually, you know, the Red Angel of Death kind of still did show up. So I guess, you know, there's no loyalty from witches. Although I guess maybe you would, I don't know. I guess from the Spellmans there is, but not from witches overall. All right, then for Harvey Kinkle, I thought that turning him into the son of a family of witch hunters, a long line of witch hunters, was a really good idea and makes him and Sabrina even more star-crossed lovers, not just mortal and witch, but also witch hunter and witch. I thought that was great. And also, I thought it was hilarious that their family name was really Von Kinkle. That's like, I get it. Okay, Van Helsing, right? But then also, why would they drop the Von? They're like, you know, it would be better if we were the Kinkles. I'd be like, no, I think you should keep the Von. It sounds better. I mean, also, the town loves that family and they hate witches. So I don't see, like, I wouldn't think they would be trying to escape their past or anything like that, right? I also like the history of the mines and that they originally were the property of witches, which would explain why Satan keeps showing up down there and stuff. I thought that stuff was all really good. And I also think the show genuinely came up with a really good way to force Sabrina and Harvey to at least take a break, right? I mean, thanks to her, he had to point blank shoot his own brother. That was tough. That was like Haunting of Hill House kind of stuff, right? It was very good because it really got you with the feels too. And Ross Lynch, to that actor's credit, I thought he did a really good job with it. This could have also been a thankless role, but he's very charismatic. I think he's very good. And I hope that Sabrina never tells him how close she was to getting Tommy out of purgatory. I mean, they were right at the gate, and then she just had his freaking arm. I mean, she kind of killed him like 3 times, right? Well, she killed him twice and made Tommy kill him a third time. And I was like, wow, Sabrina, sometimes is, you know, the famous saying, sometimes there's help that, you know, people can do without. And I think Sabrina is getting very close to that area. Then, of course, we're all wondering what Prudence is going to do now that she realizes she has a birthright claim to Father Blackwood's seat of power. I thought that was good, but she seemed so nice when the kids were being born, I guess her step-siblings. I was like, why are you being so helpful at this birth? That lady tried to kill you. And I was like, that's a crazy time to lose your edge, Prudence, but I guess she just likes being part of a family, kind of. I don't know. I forgot. Did Lady Blackwood die in birth? I think she did, in childbirth. Yeah, I think she did. That was convenient for everybody in the story and creating it, because I think it's going to free up a lot of storylines going forward. And we know that no good can come out of Aunt Zelda's affair with Father Blackwood, right? I mean, I felt actually kind of bad for Zelda because that was clearly such a bad idea. And it's a real credit to Miranda Otto that she allowed the character to maintain her dignity while still going down that path, right? And it was also a bad idea to steal his twin daughter and leave him only with his newborn son. Although that was a great cover story when she said, oh, the son, the, you know, one child ate the other or absorbed the other. And I was like, you know, I was like, well, I believe that. That was great. I fell for it. And I was like, oh my God, there's another kid. And I'm not sure how I feel about them taking another child into the Spellman household. I would love for their army of righteousness to grow, right? But are they going to maybe, I hope they can find a spell. I hope like Zelda gets fed up of taking care of the baby and gets a spell to age that kid up. Because I don't really know if I want a baby storyline in season 2. Those can be a real drag. And I have no idea what that tease was at the end with Hilda's new love interest, Dr. Cerebrus. That seems super forced. And I was like, why are his eyes glowing red? What's happening? I don't know. It was weird. It was, I mean, it just so came out of nowhere and like so didn't go anywhere that I was like, what? I mean, the show doesn't really know what to do with Hilda, which is a shame because Lucy Davis is just so wonderful and charming. And then, finally, the award for biggest wasted opportunity goes to Chance Perdomo. I mean, what a shame. He started out the season so strong. But then he just seemed to become willfully ignorant as the season progressed and did some really stupid things. I'm also annoyed that the murdered warlock subplot he got at the beginning of the show and then with the parents later committing suicide for Halloween. And I was like, I think they were killed, right? I mean, they just basically abandoned that mystery, at least for now. Maybe they're going to bring it back in season 2. But I thought that story, and I think, you know, Chance Perdomo didn't get enough justice in season 1. So that's my spoiler review for season 1 of The Chilling Adventures of Sabrina. What did you dislike and like about season 1? What are you looking forward to in season 2? And who who are your favorite characters so far? Share your thoughts down below. And of course, as always, you can check out some more episodes right now.